Hi, everyone. I'm Claudia Bester. I'm the Director of Public Programs here at the Hammer Museum, and I want to welcome you all to tonight's talk with Ruben Molina and Garay. Tonight's talk is part of the Hammer Museum's biennial exhibition, Made in LA, which opened 2 weeks ago. I hope you'll all have a chance to come and see the entire exhibition at some point. It's really a love letter to Los Angeles made by artists who live here. And it's utterly fantastic, so please come and see the whole exhibition. We're all currently inside an exhibition space featuring artworks by Garay. Garay is a multidisciplinary artist, performer, DJ, and record collector based here in LA. His art is informed by his lived experiences crossing the US-Mexico border, recognizing and drawing attention to the rich and dynamic culture of everyday life across the border. He's the founder of the music collective Más Éxitos, host of the Dub Lab radio program, Más Éxitos con Ganas, and co-founder of Discos Rolas, a record label and collaborative project dedicated to the musical histories of Latin America. Garay has exhibited and performed nationally and internationally, including solo exhibitions at the Vincent Price Museum, LACMA, the San Diego Museum of Art, the Santa Monica Museum of Art, the National Museum of Mexican Art in Chicago, and of course here at the Hammer, and at La Pau Gallery, Cell Gallery, and Charlie James Gallery, among others. He received his MFA from UC San Diego and a BFA from the Art Center College of Design. As part of his Hammer Made in LA biennial exhibition, Garay invited the noted music historian Ruben Molina here to speak in dialogue with him. Ruben is a true public historian and a serious record collector. As a teenager in the 1960s, he'd take a bus to Hollywood to shop for records, and his passion for vinyl continues to this day. He's DJed with the Southern Soul Spinners crew since 2010. As a dedicated community historian, Molina interviewed dozens of the artists whose music he loves. In 2002, he published the book, The Old Barrio Guide to Lowrider Music, 1950 to 1975. It's now an out-of-print collector's item selling online for hundreds of dollars. He followed it up in 2007 with a new book, Chicano Soul, Recordings and History of an American Culture, which was the first ever history of Mexican-American soul and R&B. In 2017, a second edition was released. It's technically out of print, or we would have had them for sale here tonight, but there are copies available online, and I highly recommend it. So tonight, Garay and Ruben will talk about Lowrider and Chicano Soul with clips and samples. Afterwards, we invite everyone to stay and socialize. We will have coffee, tea, and conchas for everyone. And Garay and Ruben will also spin some records on Garay's custom sonidero cart, which you can see in the background. So without further ado, I give you Ruben Molina and Garay Garay. Right.
Thank you for a great introduction. Man, thanks to the Hammer, Made in LA, beautiful exhibition. Pablo, Diana, great work. Thanks for including me in the show. And thank you, Ruben, for being here.
My pleasure, man. I mean, thank you for the invite.
Man, big fan. Thank you all for being here. See lots of friends and those who I don't know. Thank you extra. Man, here we go. For me, this story starts off with Kevin Ramos, In Orbito, part of Más Éxitos. And Kevin mentioned to me, hey man, you know about Ruben Molina? And I was like, nah, I don't think I do. Well, you need to check him out, man. He's got this book called Chicano Soul that just dropped. And checked that out and was kind of stunned on what I saw. Just so you can have a look, this is the book, how I learned about Ruben and his work. And after that, I realized he had a book that he had written prior to called The Barrio Guide of Lowrider Oldies. And we had just started a night at the Verdugo Bar, which is in Northeast Los Angeles. This bar used to cater to Dodger fans and Raider fans, and pretty much just that, and catered to drinkers. This bar had recently gotten sold, and my friend Kevin and I and another friend Jose, who's part of Double Lab Radio, we were all fans of Latin American records, and we felt like, you know, we would go out and in digger culture, what a digger is somebody who looks for records, digs for records, and may play them, may not play them, may just collect them. But we would go out to these events where diggers were playing, you know, their records and having nights. And every once in a while, you would hear a Latin jam and get me really excited. And as our neighborhoods are changing, we decided to try to do a night that focused on all Latin American-based records, all genres. And so we did. We started a night called Más Éxitos, which actually started off as visual art. And then we're like, you know what, man, let's gentrify the sound in the neighborhood because it's really changing. And we got a lot of great music to share. And I might note that, like, I wanted to learn more also. So this was a way that I can hear more records and hear more rhythms and learn about more labels and more histories. And so we did. And long story short, Kevin mentioned to me, hey, we should invite Ruben Molina to play at Más Éxitos. And I was like, let's do it. Ruben agreed. And that's the night that I got the Chicano Soul book. Your autograph is in there. Earlier, we were hearing a CD that he compiled that he gave me that went along with that book, or maybe like a loose promo, that primarily focused on San Antonio-based soul, doo-wop, R&B, harmony groups, right? And Ruben pulled up and schooled us all. His records were amazing, and that's where our relationship started. And so I'm really pleased to invite him, and thanks again for coming. And so today we're going to talk about Ruben Molina and his journey through this music, and what he thinks about this music. And, you know, one really cool thing about Ruben for me is that you're a record collector, but you became an author. You became a, you know, a publisher. I don't know, man. You just do your own thing, and you do it well. And super happy to have you here.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
So, what are some early memories for you of music before record collecting?
Those. I think it's a similar story that goes across, you know, our culture. It's always been since I was 5 years old, 6 years old. What my mom would play as she cleaned on Saturdays and Sundays, you know. And my mom, at the time, she was like probably 21 years old, and she had four kids already. But we had this, we were renting this house that had this huge living room and dining room kind of together, so it had hardwood floors. Well, it had carpeting, but the first thing she told my dad was, pull up the carpeting, throw it away. I'm going to polish these floors. So they were like really shiny. So, you know, so she would dance. And she would play this music. Because she was 21. I mean, it was what was going on in 1961, 1962. Stevie Wonder, the Smokey Robinson, Jackie Wilson, whatever was on the radio. And she just loved, like, when they would come out on TV and, kids, come here. You got to see, it was the Five Stair Steps. And they were like little kids, but they had these songs, World of Fantasy and Come Back and stuff. And those songs stayed with me for till now. I play them now because, and they just don't ever get old. But that's where it started for me, just watching her enjoy music and, you know, getting that enjoyment myself as time went by. And really when I asked about buying records, well, she had to buy them for me because I was 11 years old, And so she would take me to like the Singer sewing machine company. And in the back, they sold the sewing machines and stuff. Way in the back, they had a rack of records just like different like Sears and stuff like that. So every once in a while, I'd come home with two or three records. And she liked it. I mean, she liked that I enjoyed that, you know, music. And she tried to pay to have me learn instruments and stuff. But I was a listener, really. I didn't pick up actually playing till later on. But yeah.
In this house, in this shiny floor, your mom danced on was where?
We lived in Elysian Valley, off of Riverside Drive. I was born in 1953 in Lincoln Heights. At that time of in LA, in Lincoln Heights, there was a hotel called the Broadway Hotel on North Broadway, and if you were from El Paso, Texas, that's where you went. My dad started going there in 1949. He was 17, and he would come to work, and then 1950 he'd come back. I have the postcards that he would write to her and tell her how things were here. And then my brother was born in Texas, and then they came in 53, and I was born in 1953 right there in Lincoln Heights. And then we found the house in Elysian Valley, and that's where we stayed for the next 20 years.
Great. And let us know, like, what were some of those first experiences, you know, hearing doo-wop, soul, hop, things of that nature?
So many of those records, Don Julian, Jesse Belvin, that kind of doo-wop, early rhythm and blues, my mom would play that, and my dad would play that. And my dad, because he was a Texan, whenever Texas musicians would come to LA, they would play down at the 5-4 Ballroom in South Central Los Angeles. So him and his homies, you know, would get together and go to support fellow Texans, like Pee Wee Creighton, Johnny Guitar Watson, some of the other, T-Bone Walker, things like that. So those records wound up in our house as well. But, you know, we're kids and we're running around and we have a lot of things going on besides outside of the house, running around in the streets. So it isn't till like I get to junior high school. And we used to walk like 3 miles to school every morning, and then walk home 3 miles, go through the river, over the Fletcher Bridge into Glassell Park to Irving Junior High, and the walk back. So one day, this friend of mine, Tony, he says, "Hey, my sister's gonna pick us up. Do you wanna come with us? You wanna ride home?" And I'm like, yeah, shit, you know. So the bell rings and all the kids are running around and stuff, and we run out of the gate, and there's a line of like sedans and station wagons and, you know, just picking up all the kids piling in. And he says, "There she comes." And it's this 1954 Bel Air dropped to the ground. And the pipes are, you know, and I'm looking at the car, and I'm like, whoa, damn. So we jump into the car, and I get into the back seat, and my head's like this. I mean, but you're looking at the other kids in these station wagons, and you're like, yeah, all right, we got you. And I look at his sister, and she's sitting all the way up to her boyfriend who's driving, you know, and I'm in the back seat, and then this is on the radio,
Heaven and paradise are, that's where I want to be. Just you and me in heaven and paradise.
And I'm like, you know, I'm just like, whoa. This is what I want for my life. You know, just the whole thing in front of me is like, whoa. You know, and that's kind of what I, you know, I hate to say it, but that's what I strived for. I didn't even want to go to high school. I mean, you know, later on, it was just like, this is all I want. This is all I want. You know, but so that was my, like, the first time that I really felt like the music. I mean, I've heard it, you know, here and there and stuff, but man, I felt it. And so, you know, it just, it stayed, you know, with me. A couple of years later, I'm probably like 15 years old, and you know, we were now strictly into girls. I mean, girls was everything, right? But, so anyways, this friend of mine, he lived on the next block, and he had older sisters. So, he would call me and say, hey, man, the girls are getting ready. Come over, man, come over. So I would run in the bathroom and wash my face and comb my hair and stuff. And, you know, before that, I didn't even care, you know, because all we did was play outside and stuff. But now it's like, whoa, you know. So I run over to his house, and we would just, like, sit there and watch them getting ready. You know, they're putting on makeup, and they're giggling and stuff. And we're, like, we're just sitting there like two dorks, you know, on the couch, like, looking at them. So it's let me see if I can get out of here. How do I close this out? Oh, I can't get over to where I'm at. Let's see, let's get out of there. All right, here. So we're there, like these two dorky kids, you know, and they're looking at us like, you're dirty, you know, you're like, ooh, these, what are they doing here, you know, So one of them says, hey, you know, do something, you know, put on a record. So I'm like, okay. So I go over to the record player and I'm digging and I had never heard this. So I'm gonna put this down right here. Like going through the albums, and I come across this album, and I'm looking at it, and I don't know anything that's on here, but I see that on one side it's rock, which means it's up tempo, and on the other side is the ballads, right? So I pull this record out, and I'm like, whoa, I have never seen this, you know. And it's yellow, you know. So I put it on the ballad side because I know what the ballads are, right? It's like, hey, you know, the girls are gonna dig this. And and I just put this music on.
As I love her.
So that's the Salas brothers and Cannibal and the Headhunters. The Salas brothers were probably younger than me. They were like 13, 14 years old when they did the first song that was on. But anyways, so the girls are like, oh, you know, like he really knows his what he's doing. But I didn't know. I had never heard those records. But that was like my first like introduction to the brown sound, you know, like Mexican Americans singing, you know. And it didn't really like register then. But later, as I started record collecting heavier, you know, than I was, you know, those were the records that I was looking for, and they weren't easy to find, and they're still not, you know. But that was my my first introduction to the Chicano sound.
And prior to that, you would hear some music like this, but it was primarily coming from the African American community.
Yeah, the African American music, the black music, was really where I hung my hat, because as a kid, and maybe many of the guys out here probably will relate, you know, back then, your dad, he went to work, came home, got his beer, you know, okay, but if there wasn't any like really like interactions as far as like there wasn't a lot of affection, you know. And then especially with three boys, and we're all over the place and stuff, and you know, and so and this was a time when you're learning about girls and you're learning about the birds and the bees, right? But who's gonna teach you? Your dad, he ain't gonna tell you, right? And your mom ain't gonna tell you, because turn you loose, you know, whatever, right? So the way you learned was by Smokey Robinson and the Temptations, and because the way they sang it, the way they these songs were done, is just like you wanted to hear it. You wanted to hear the poetry, and you wanted to feel what they were singing about. And at times, you know, when they're singing about a broken heart, you know, and at 15, you got a broken heart, man, because the girls they want nothing to do with you, you know. So those songs meant a lot. And I think that's why they always stayed with me, is because they just meant a lot to my life, you know.
So this is a super important compilation called the Eastside Review, which focused on Chicano bands, right?
Yeah.
Meaning rock, R&B, rhythm and blues, mm-hmm. doo-wop, soul.
Yeah.
Which is a highly collectible record. Just seeing the orange one got me all freaked out. I know in your book you got the multicolored one also, which it's is even right crazier. And I got the black one. Wah-wah. Mm. But I really love it. So after that, you recognize that those are Chicano groups, and like you said, Salas Brothers are even younger than yourself, and not too far away probably from mm-hmm. playing gigs or living around where you're at. Yeah. How did that change your perspective on soul, doo-wop, record collecting?
You know what, at that time, you're just looking for the thing that you feel. You don't really care if it's a black artist or a brown artist, or, you know, you just want that feeling. And that's why it's called soul, right? And so, you know, at that age, you don't even have like the money to go to the dances, which were all in East Los Angeles and Boyle Heights. There were some in Lincoln Heights, but we were just kids, you know. So you don't really care who it is that's making you feel good. You just want to feel good, right? So that was then. Now, later on, it was mostly the Midnighters that really like opened the door in terms of realizing, man, look at this. This is a Chicano band, you know.
Right.
And then you start going backwards, because you hit this point where you say, wow, look at these dudes, man. I mean, they You know, they had the full band with the horns and suits and everything, and you kind of see that, and then you kind of like step backwards. You want to know more, so you kind of look a little backwards and say, oh shoot, they come from the same place as Cannibal and the Headhunters, as the Premiers, as the Salas Brothers, as the Heartbreakers. They're all like part of the movement. Unfortunately, by the time I figure that out, the only way I'm gonna hear it is from records, because just about everyone, you know, disappeared except the Midnighters. And then the Salas Brothers became Tierra and things like that, right? So,
right. So
really everything lived through the records.
So when Cannibal and the Headhunters was touring with the Beatles, you were listening to those records after that or during that time?
Oh yeah, after. Because I was 11 years old when they did that, 1964. I didn't care. I was, you know, I didn't even like the Beatles, you know. To me, it was the Animals, the Rolling Stones, and them, because they were like the working class. The Beatles, even though it probably isn't true, but the Beatles were like these, the girls liked them, and you know, the guys were like, ah, man, my aunt bought us tickets to go see the Beatles in Dodger Stadium, and we refused. They ain't gonna go.
That's awesome. I like that story. So after playing Eastside Review to these girls, young women getting ready, what comes next in terms of like your journey and?
Well, they left the city and they're on the couch next to each other. Then, you know, then it's off to high school and, you know, and right there was just, you discovered Huggy Boy and you just started like, man.
Can you let people know who Huggy Boy is?
Huggy Boy was this DJ. He, in 1948, he was listening to like, this radio show on it was Dolphins of Hollywood, and the DJ, there was no DJ, so he was with his chick, and they're making out and stuff, but it's bugging him that there's no DJ on the radio, and Dolphins of Hollywood was like a big thing for rhythm and blues, doo-wop, South Central stuff,
and so meaning it was played
out of a record store. So he's making out with his chick, and he's like, nobody's on the radio. So he leaves her, he drives to Dolphins of Hollywood, and he tells them, you don't have a DJ. And the guy says, yeah, the dude left. He goes, I'll do it. And the guy says, well, okay, you know, but this is a black station, man, so you get one day. Tomorrow we're having a black DJ. So, you know, Huggy Boy was Anglo. At the record store, Dolphins, it was like a window and the street and the speakers are outside, and he gets in there and he starts doing his thing and they keep him. And it becomes another destination for the raza, for blacks, for Filipinos, anybody that really liked rhythm and blues, doo-wop would drive down to Dolphins. And like all the groups that were like doo-wop groups, during the week, they would record a record, they would press it, and then deliver it directly to Huggy Boy. And he would, this is a new one by the Turks, and boom, drop the record. 78s.
Why do you think people gravitated towards Huggy Boy? What did he do? Like, why did he keep the job
day? He was charismatic, and he spoke to the people. And he spoke on that level of make you feel like you're one of us. It wasn't like the other DJs that were, you know, it's like more commercialized and stuff. Nah, Huggy Boy was like right there. And I think that was his appeal throughout his life, because he turned down bigger things just to stay an East LA dude. You know, play Radio Cali rather than KHJ or KRA. You know, he'd rather be with Radio Cali because they gave him that moment. You know.
And Radio Cali was a Spanish language radio station.
Yeah.
Was his show the only show that was English?
I don't know. But then, you know, he had his dance show. I think it was in Montebello, where people went, and it was a television show. And, you know, that was the only place you see homies, you know, decked out, dancing, you know, with their elbows up and all that stuff, right? And so that's how much, you know, he was. Like, nobody else was going to do that for the homies, you know.
Right, he was for the neighborhood.
Yeah, yeah.
And what kind of things, or what'd you learn from Huggy Boy in terms of music?
Well, he brought the doo-wop, the real, like, deep, you know, like, there's really like Tony Allen would say, don't call it the West Coast doo-wop. It's, we're group harmony. We're not doo-wop. Doo-wop's the East Coast, you know. But he gave a place for that music from South LA, from Fremont High, from Jefferson High. You know, he gave them the place. And then once he got in, he gave it the same place to the Chicano groups. Because, like, Cannibal and the Headhunters, like the Premieres, like, none of them really made it on KRLA, KHJ. The Midnighters did, Cannibal did with Land of a Thousand Dances, but everything else was contained like on the East Side, and Huggy Boy was the one that was playing their records, that was promoting them, that was promoting the shows for the Chicano bands, you know, to the Chicano audience. And there would always be a mix of Chicano, young Chicano musicians, groups, singers, and black. So you would see like the Superbs, the Whispers, the Young Hearts, along with the Cannibal and the Headhunters, the Midnighters, and such, you know.
So black, Chicano, and mixed race groups, primarily what he was playing on his show. Could that have been where you heard Chuck Higgins' Pachuco Hop?
No, I didn't like Chuck Higgins, man. I mean, that's a whole, like, that came later. It's like I said, you get into something and then you start going backwards. And you know, I think I was into like Big J McNeely first. And then you start kind of digging into these sax players and stuff, and boom, you find Chuck Higgins and Joe Houston, and then you realize that, hey, these dudes have been around since the 40s and the 50s doing this thing. And then I came across the record Pachuco Hop, and you know, that's like this other, you know, revelation that happens, because now I'm like, what's this Pachuco stuff, man? And then you start looking for records by Don Tosti and Lalo Guerrero and other groups like that. So that, it's all like part of record collecting, which you know, when you find something, you try to go backwards and find some history on things. Yeah.
Great. So what's the next thing you got lined up for us in this kind of is this a timeline we're hearing this music in? Is this like a timeline? Are these tracks that you're playing us kind of coming as you remember them, or like, you know, by year or era of your music, listening or collecting?
Those first ones, yeah, but you know, I remember I had to do this thing for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and it was in Clear Lake, Iowa, and it was in the same place where Richie Valens died, and you know, so they asked me to come up and do a talk and promote the book, the Chicano Soul book. So, and they said, okay, you're gonna be on stage with Los Lonely Boys, Chris Montez, and Los Lobos, and you guys are gonna have this conversation about Chicano music, right? So I'm, all right, I'll do it. So I get to Clear Lake, and the woman that's kind of leading me around and stuff, she says, can I ask you something? I said, yeah. Can you do this by yourself? And I'm like, what? And she says, you know, and this is the same weather. It's the same day that the plane crashed that killed, you know, Buddy Holly, Big Bopper, and Richie Valens. So the weather's the same. January 20th. It's just 50 years later. And it's like, the weather sucks. So she says, nobody can make it. All the planes are down. Everything's closed. You're the only one that made it. So get out there. And, you know, I started thinking, I go, man, you know, people think, and I think it was like back then, you know, how people must have felt that Richie Valens, like, passed away right when he was, like, about to break through. And so in doing, you know, right away I started doing research. Whatever it is, I have to, like, do some research. So I thought, man, he wasn't alone. I mean, he passed away, but he was only like 6 months. Everything he did in 6 months, from October to January, and that was it, he was gone. But at the same time, Freddie Fender was, Baltimore Huerta was coming up in Texas. Mondo and the Chili Peppers, they're coming out of San Antonio. Over here, we had the Velveteens. You have bands in Pomona, in Pacoima, the Perez Brothers in Pacoima. Another group in Wilmington. They were all kind of doing the same thing. And the Chicano music didn't die, you know. Richie passed away, but the scene was alive, and all these groups were spawning and creating other musicians. And Richie's band that was with him in Pacoima, they went off into other directions, and they created bands and what's his name? The Brown Brothers of Soul.
Ruly Garcia.
Yeah, Ruly Garcia.
AKA Johnny Chingas.
Yeah, Johnny Chingas. He comes out of that, but years later. But still, all of those seeds were planted. And Richie was one of the seeds, but he just didn't get to spawn like the rest of them did. And so I brought some, we'll play some of that. This is like the early, like not, all of this is like from 1957.
On affair, when two policemen grabbed me unaware. It says your name Henry, I says, why show? It says you the boy I've been looking for.
She's my sugar.
So that's like some samples of 1957. And you can see, you can kind of feel the that they're black, they're covering black artists. Framed was by the Robins, and Cherry Pie was Marvin and Johnny. The third one, Swinging Mike Martinez, is called Sugar Baby. And if you kind of paid attention, he's saying sugar, sugar baby. And that always got me, because my mom, you know, from Texas, and she would always say, mijo, move the chair, or my shoulder hurts. You know, it was like this, you know, and he's saying it the same way, sugar baby. You know, it's like, it's a, must be a Texas thing, you know. So you can see, like, things were moving, and young Chicanos that were brought up in conjunto or playing, you know, Mexican music at home with their uncle's guitar, their parents' guitar, were listening to rock and roll, and like, I want to do this. And I remember Don Tosti telling us one time that during that era of the Pachuco music, you could say, there was this, it was the big band era. Glenn Miller, and, you know, there was just big bands, but he was saying, all us young guys, we didn't want to do big band music. We wanted to do what was hip. And I think that's the same feeling going into the 60s, that the Chicano artists, they didn't really want to do música mexicano. They wanted to be hip. So you see on many of these records, one side is English and the flip side is in Spanish. So they were giving to both of them, which really made, as they continued and grew, It really made him dynamic, because they could play in an auditorium, and they could do both, and they could get everybody moving, you know, or they could tour and one night play for a Mexicano audience, especially coming out of Texas. They would go up into Michigan, into Chicago, into Wisconsin, and all these other states that the farm workers worked at. So they would go in, do a show for the adults in Spanish, and then do a show for the teens in English and rock and roll.
Right.
So, which you really don't find that a lot, you know.
Right, and it made those records harder to find, you know, for the average non-Spanish speaking person, because you see a polka or a conjunto jam or a corrido on one side, you're like, oh, there's not going to be nothing on that other side for me. And yet, it's got some stomping soul or rock and roll or rhythm and blues on the B side.
Like here in Los Angeles, when somebody mentions Sonny and the Sunliners, you think of, you know, Should I Take You Home? You think of The One That's Hurting Is You. Think, you know, all the English songs. But really, I think they recorded maybe 30 albums, and only maybe three are in English.
Right.
The rest is all polkas and you know, música mexicano.
Right. For you, I mean, the Lowrider seemed to be something that was there right from the get-go, right? Right from coming to school, getting picked up that day. Where did you see yourself kind of like more participating in this idea of chicanismo, pachucos, cholos, lowriders, and like what that sound was for that community?
All of that just, you know, it just comes with time and with age and knowledge, you know, like I like politically, we went to the Chicano moratorium. I think I was 16 when Ruben Salazar was killed, right? And it was, you know, it was like this eye opener. You're like, whoa, what's going on here? And tear gas and all this stuff. And you leave there feeling a certain way. And the sanctuary is the barrio. So you go back to your neighborhood, and that's really where you would just want to be. You don't want to, you know, everything that's out there is not really working in your favor. So you just make the barrio your home and your sanctuary, and so you just start working on cars. Everybody's in their driveway or backyard or wherever, and we start building cars and we start modifying them, make turning them to lowriders. And really, like, the term lowrider, nobody really used that term until Lowrider magazine came out. But before that, you were just building cars and you were just, what you were really trying to do was chicks. It all goes back to girls. So that's the thing, because you want to cruise the boulevard, and you know, so you just Saturdays, you're just getting your car ready for Saturday night. And part of the car is the music. The music's like super important. And not every Chicano is into the same thing, right? So you go to the dances and all the bands, they play really up-tempo dance music and stuff like that. But it's the cars where you just like play the slow jams, man, and you don't, it's like Chicano elevator music. You know, like, don't step on my elevator, man. And you know, guys would get in your car and pull out a cassette, you know, hey man, an A-track, back in the A-tracks, right? Put this on, I just made it, and if it wasn't like tough, man, if it wasn't just like killer slow jam, man, get out of the car, man, you ain't, pull
you're,
it out,
you're walking.
Man, pull it out. So, you know, and that's what all that was, and you know, As the lowrider became really popular and really, because all it was junky cars. It was cars that nobody wanted. And the Chevy, all right, so let's talk cars, man. So like General Motors, top of the line Cadillac, next below that is Buick, then let's see, what's the other GM Pontiac? One? Huh?
Pontiac?
Yeah, Pontiac. And then Chevy. Chevy was like the poor man's GM. You know, and that's why we got him, because it was like, after 10 years, people would just like, give me $50 for it, you know, like, so, you know, in 20 years, like, I bought a 54 Chevy in 1974, around there, for like $50, you know, and I'm like, oh, man, you know, and they're like, can you get it out of our driveway, you know, but, you know, you just went and you started playing with it, and you loved them, man, and you just gave them love, dude, and those cars were good. And so there was that, and then there was the car clubs, but the car clubs were like, they were like the high-class dudes. They were like, you know, they would look down on the lowrider dudes, the homie lowriders, like, and they had these, the big long cars, man, and they had all that pink paint and all of this stuff, like, flashy, man. And we're like, man, we don't care about none of that stuff. But that's where Lowrider magazine, like, they were, you know, the Gypsy Rose, the all of these Impalas and stuff like that. But we were the ones playing around, and I hate to say it, but we were the ones stealing the pumps off of trucks and figuring out that if we cut a hole in the frame, we could build hydraulics, and then we just needed these pumps. So you went to the trucks with the lift and with your wrenches, you know, and now you had this like car that dropped. But then they took it and they souped them up and made it like hopping cars and stuff. But we just wanted to bring the car low, and when we seen the cops, we could raise it back up, you know. But they took it to another level. So, and it's like being like chemist in, you know, just let's try this. And sometimes somebody's car would start on fire, you know, or you know, things like that. But that was like the fun of it all.
And from like that time, when did you start seeing yourself, oh man, I'm now collecting, I'm kind of becoming an archivist, or like an archaeologist, a musicologist of this music? And like, when did you realize that? And from that point in time, when did you start writing about this stuff and collecting ephemera?
Like in?
Because that's a big leap from collecting and listening to music and enjoying it to collecting ephemera to writing multiple books. That's day and night.
Yeah, what happened is, you know, on Sundays I used to listen to Johnny Otis. Johnny Otis had this radio show, and Johnny Otis was a big band leader back in the 40s. I mean, he did like Big Mama Thornton, Hound Dog. He did, man, some of the big records out coming out of South Central. So, anyways, in the 70s he had a radio show, and I called the radio show because he would always say, man, call me and tell me what you think about this, you know, to the audience, right? So one day I call and I say, hey Johnny, you know, and I ask him a question about this record, and he's like, man, who are you? You know, and I said, oh, Ruben Molina. And then he goes, man, I like your voice. Do you want to sing? And I said, no, I don't want to sing, man. I said, I'm calling you about like these slow jams that you're playing, and somebody should write a book about it. And then he said, well, why don't you write it? You could do it. And I'm like, well, like, it just like slapped me in the face, because I'm thinking, man, I didn't even really go to school, you know, and stuff. So then I thought, you know what? Why not? I don't, you know. So I just started researching everything, and that's when I did this book. And again, you know, that was like, I took it to a publisher, and they're like, man, who are you trying to sell this to? You know, nobody's gonna buy this. And I go, oh shit. But then I said, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna pay for it myself. And so then I just started selling them at Lowrider car shows. And they started.
Around what years?
Huh?
Around what years?
About 98, around there, 98, 99. And the funny thing about it is, like, the book, I try to put as many photos of the bands. So, like, people would come up and buy the book and walk away. And then 10 minutes later, they'll come back and say, hey, give me back my money. Why? I thought this was about Chicano groups. This is nothing but black artists. I'm like, you think Barbara Mason's Chicano? You think Billy Stewart's Chicano? What have you been listening to you all your life? And they're like, damn, you're right. You know, because it's always been a mix of black and brown, but you know, I would say 75% black, you know, and you know, so that's when I started to, like, my brain started ticking, you know. It's like, we don't really know a lot about each other or ourselves, you know. We really don't know. We talk a lot about culture and about our culture, but what do we really know about our culture, you know, other than what someone else might tell us and stuff? And, you know, that's why I think writing books, you know, is a way to introduce ourselves to other people, but also to our own selves.
Right.
You know, because, I mean, how many people out here really knew, like, this scene in San Antonio, Texas, that was just thriving with, you know, bands and all of this music? Even in East Los Angeles, a lot of people don't know it existed. And you know, so I think that's pretty cool thing to introduce not only to ourselves, but, like, to the world. So that book started selling heavy in Japan and in Europe. So, like, now the Europeans are like, wait a minute, man, these are our records. But the one side, on soul records, it's usually one side is up-tempo, and then the other side's the downside, the ballad. And in Europe, they play the up-tempo records. But now they see that I'm promoting this thing with the records that they want, but it's the flip side.
Right.
So now they start inviting me to go to Europe and play over there, but play our side. And it's weird because I tell them, well, you got the records. You have the records, so just flip it. why do you need to pay for my airfare and my hotel when you could just flip it? And they said, no, we want the closest thing to the music. It really doesn't matter the record. It's like, how close can we get to the black and brown artists that recorded these records, you know?
And maybe, right? what you would play before it and after it, and how that tells a story or gives a vibe.
Yeah.
This book right here is amazing, and I was telling Ruben, like, he gives away so many secrets in this book. If you have this book, you can know about so much. And I remember when I got it, I thought to myself I was going to do that. Like, I'm going to go page by page, look at all these jams, find the songs I want, and get them, you know? But today I realized, like, what this actually kind of reminds me of was, like, in baseball card collecting, there's a book called Beckett, and it would tell you what baseball cards are worth and where they came from. And, you know, usually a lot of the baseball cards that were worth money were the misprints, right, were the mistakes or something like that. But I realized, oh, man, this kind of functions like a Beckett, you know, and it just made me realize why it is so sought after right now, why it's out of print and why it costs so much, because there's a plethora of secrets in this book that you're willing to share. And I think that's why I mentioned to you, that's why you're a profe, you're a professor, because you share this knowledge. You're not hoarding it and keeping it and getting doubles or triples of these records and selling it for crazy money now, because a lot of this stuff, I'm sure when you got it and you wrote this book, you're finding it at a yard sale, at a swap meet, in the back of a dead stock record shop, something like that. But we're in the era of
Discogs.
Discogs. And eBay and Etsy and, you know, Mercado Negro and all this other stuff, you know? And a lot of this stuff goes for, you know, between $4,000 to $100. Like, $100 now is a cheap record, right? It's like the old $5 record.
Yeah.
And it's pretty amazing to see all that history in this book. And so from the old Barrio Guide to Lowrider Music, 1950 to 1975, how does Chicano Soul start to birth?
So in working on the old Barrio Guide, because I would go like to different neighborhoods. Now like car building, clothing, dress, it's all competition among barrios. It's like, hey, that neighborhood, man, they know how to dress, and that neighborhood, they know how to fix cars, and that neighborhood has the best records. You know, that's the way we work in the little neighborhoods out there, and so we were like known for the records, the music, you know, and we were fortunate to have elders within our own barrio that were collectors, so they pass it down to us, and we, you know, so.
And Frogtown's right next to Los Feliz, Silver Lake, Hollywood, East Hollywood. Yeah, so you're close to the industry of records.
Right? But that it wasn't that like American music in downtown. That was it, dude. It's that piece of vinyl that you want. Really, you don't care about the industry. You just want the piece of vinyl. And for us, it was American music, Sounds of Music in East LA, and a couple of other shops. But what was I going to say? What was the question?
About going from the old Barrio Guide to Chicano Soul, because they're distinctly different books.
So I would go like to different like barrios and say, hey, man, what do you, you know, what's like your favorite songs, and what do you guys listen to? And every once in a while, somebody would have a relative from San Antonio, or a relative from El Paso or Albuquerque or Phoenix, and they would say, hey, man, so-and-so brought this record, you know? And so now you're like, wait a minute, there's a lot of brown music here. So as soon as I finished that book, I started doing research on the Chicano Soul book. I just flew down to San Antonio. I know nobody in San Antonio, but I flew down there, and I slept at the airport. And the following day, I just went down and I started asking people, hey, do you know? I was looking for Dimas Garza, and they were like, no, why are you looking for him? You know, they're all protective, but that's the way it is here too. You go to East LA and start asking questions, man, they get protective, right? So I'm coming back. So I go to the airport to come home with nothing, and this guy calls me and he says, hey, you down here looking for Dimas? Yeah. He says, well, come back. He wants to talk to you. I said, man, I'm at the airport. I got to go home. I got to work tomorrow. So he says, well, come back next week. Okay. So I go home. Now I got to tell my wife that I'm leaving Friday to go back to San Antonio. And she's like, what? What are you doing? So I come back to San Antonio, and Dimas Garza, the Royal Jesters, Rudy T, it was just like this crowd of artists. And they, what are you doing? We want to help. And when I went back, I took a laptop, I took a scanner, I took a recorder, and I was just taking people's stories and scanning their photos, and we just all night, you know, went at it. And that's how I started on that book.
Man, when I got that book, you gave me a CD, which was called Chicano Soul Volume 2. And speaking of Albuquerque, I noticed how many mm-hmm. bands were from Albuquerque. It's yeah. like, I never see records from Albuquerque.
Yeah. Yeah.
You found those all in Texas?
No,
those are also, you went to Albuquerque.
Once I did San Antonio, and you know, the thing about like books and that you write about other people and things is the minute you get your first interview, you have to finish. You can't let that person down. So after interviewing Dimas, I was like, I'm going to go all out because I don't want to get a call 2 years from now, hey, what'd you do? Whatever happened to the, you know? So then I started flying to Albuquerque, to Phoenix, to El Paso, to Dallas, to Houston, and just interviewing people. But now I had the connection because Dimas was so like revered among all of the Texas singers that if I just drop his name, you know, and they're like, oh, you interviewed Dimas? And, yeah. And at the same time, no one knew about them here. See, it's like two separate worlds. Except those record collectors that are here, the pesky record collectors that know, man. They're like, hey, dude, you got that, man? You know, they know, but like no one, right? So I asked Dimas, I asked this group from San Antonio, will you come and perform in LA, right? And they were like, nah, man. And these dudes, man, they all speak like pachucos, man. Chale, ese, puro this and that, like that, right? And I'm like, you know, are you sure? Yeah. So then Dimas says, I'm going. That's been my dream. I've never, because those guys never really went out of San Antonio. So he says, I'm going to go. That's my dream, was to sing in California. All of them jumped on. Boom, we're in, you know. And so I came back here, and we got this Chicano lawyer group to raise the money to bring them, because I didn't have no money. And then Cal State Riverside, we put on a show there, right? Man, it was just awesome, dude. You know, just first time all of these guys to be out here in LA, and it was really something, you know.
That's awesome. So I take it maybe around this time you're collecting promo photos,
yeah,
posters,
yeah, mm-hmm,
other kind of ephemera and yeah, things like that mm-hmm come along with records and music.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So a lot of these scans and some of these books are things that you got on site while interviewing, and some of this stuff is also your personal collection?
Some of the stuff, they actually, some guys just wanted to give it to me, but I can't take things, you know, from people. And like I would tell them, because, and it's not only the Chicano artists, but black artists, it's, you know, they really never save anything from their past. And I'm doing this project, but I don't want to take their history. So I would say, you know what? Let me scan it and then frame it and keep it. Because maybe you don't care, but your grandkids might care. Someone's going to, and a lot of them, they didn't even have their own records or anything like that. So whatever I got, I always gave it back. But a couple of them just insisted that I take the posters and things like that, you know, and keep them, you know, so.
I want to ask you about, I want to see what year this is. Do you remember what year this is, this Wax Poetic?
I would say maybe 2013, 2014.
So there's this magazine called Wax Poetics. And for record diggers, this is a really cool magazine. I believe it came out of San Francisco,
uh-huh,
or it comes out of San Francisco. For a while, they stopped publishing, and I feel like this is when they kind of came back. At this point, they did their first Latin issue. And I was like, damn, they did a Latin issue? This is crazy. And I had the great fortune to go with a friend of ours named Brian Cross, known as B+, an amazing music photographer, hip-hop photographer, just all in general music collector type photographer, right? And at this point, you had played Mas Éxitos, and he was like, hey, I'm going to go check out Ruben. They're doing something called Southern Soul Spinners at a sports bar. I can't remember if it was Pico Rivera or something like that.
La Puente.
La Puente.
Oh, no, that was in Pomona.
It was Pomona. In Pomona. Yeah. So I'm like, yeah, let's go check it out. We go to, like I said, a sports bar. It's the afternoon.
Yeah.
We probably got there at 12 in the afternoon.
Yeah.
Hot as hell. And right away, it was a cool scene there because outside of the bar, there was all kinds of stands.
It was at Original Mike's in Orange County.
Original Mike's. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
And man, that's probably the last time I got a copy of Teen Angels, because after that, they just went bananas in price. But you know, there would be Lowrider, vintage magazines. There would be CDs. I saw your CD there. That was called the West Side Sound. Is that what it was called? The West Side Sound.
West Side Sound. Yeah.
And so saw you perform that day. I believe Solera and Josh Whitmore.
Josh wasn't with us then. It was like George Miller.
It was George Miller.
Yeah. No.
And that was an amazing night. And that was kind of the first time I got a lot of this music that you're talking about, but all in like one big chingazo, you know, all afternoon. Yeah. And it was really cool. Also in this issue, they feature Art LaBeau. And I remember thinking, oh man, how rad for Ruben that he's in Wax Poetics, you know, because for diggers, that's like a cool place to be, right?
Yeah.
And get in your story. But at that time, I also knew, like, damn, it's over. Like, the Latin records, they're going to go up in price.
Yeah.
It's like, all the record heads going to know about this stuff. The clues are out there. People are talking about it. It looks dope, right? And how did things change for you from this point? Because of Wax Poetics or not because of Wax Poetics, but from this point, how did have things changed? Because I imagine they have dramatically. In terms of the way you're received or, you know, what you're collecting, maybe the other collectors you deal with.
Yeah.
You even deal with other collectors. I guess I never even asked you that.
No, I try not to, man. But, you know, that whole period itself, it was just almost like a period like of invention, you know? My records up to that point, well, Josh was the first one to ask me to play in a gallery setting, right? And then you asked me to play. But other than that, I had never really taken my records out of my house, ever, you know? I mean, I didn't think about it. And then they asked me to do that show at Original Mike's. And we did it, and I wasn't like uncomfortable. A lot of the music that we play, especially the, you know, that it's slow jams and stuff, it's its heart is in the cholo. And when you get a lot of homies together, you know, things could go bad. And you have to do things. You have to do things like with a little bit of class, a little bit of style, because whatever you do on stage kind of sets the tone for the people that are out there. And especially when they're drinking, you do something in a bar, they're gonna drink, and the bar wants to make sure that they're making their money. So, but I'm looking at the crowd and I'm like, okay, everybody just, you know, stay, be cool, man. And anyway, so that first event, I just like felt that we could do a little different. And so that's when I started George, Soleta, and myself started Southern Soul Spinners. And we put it into a dance hall, into a VFW hall. And so, God, right away it was like 250, 300 people. Packed. And it's all homies. So, like, the show begins with me saying, okay, look, I know everybody's here from different neighborhoods. I know that things on the street, but man, if anybody starts a fight, we'll never do this again. We'll end it that minute. And from then on, for 11 years, it was cool. Everybody, and matter of fact, people became friends. It just became like this really cool scene that they still ask for, but you know, we just don't do it anymore. But it's, I guess you could say, man, like I was really proud that not for myself, but for them, but you know, for the people that came out, that they saw something that they wanted to keep, and they were willing to like put down their hatchets, you know, right. Just like I want to keep coming. I don't want this to end, you know. And everybody was like cool, and still everybody, you know, that was around then.
It inspired a lot of people. Yeah. I mean, some music videos were made during some of those dances. Something in Myron, I'm forgetting.
Yeah, Myron and E video came out of that. Yeah. I mean, the guys there at Stone's Throw Records, they were just like in love with what we were doing, and really like I don't think anyone had ever thought of taking the music out of the cars and putting it into a dance hall. And when we did that, it just like blew everybody away. It's like, man, you could actually sustain 5-6 hours of slow jams. You know, and that's how deep our collections of music, you know, are or were.
Right. And we got to shout out Soleta, you know, because prior to that time, I mean, women been DJing forever. But Soleta at that point in time, she was one of the only females out there doing it. And as you know, it could be harsh. You know what I mean?
And Arlene, man, she was the enforcer. Like, I would say, like, I would get us in huddle, you know, and Arlene would be the one, man. Don't you be starting trouble in our thing, you know. So that was fun. It was fun to see her work. And you know, I would tell her, Arlene, you know, you don't have to cuss, man. You know, they're with us. You don't want to cuss. Oh, man. But they loved it, man. They loved at the end of the night that she would say, show's over, get the F out. And everybody would just get up and start walking out the door, you know, it's like,
No, and it's something like, because when you're in a car and you're in a lowrider, Q&A, yeah. But maybe the last kind of thought is that, like, you know, when you're at home and you're in a car, it's a private thing, and then that became a public event, right? It became for the people, and thanks for sharing all this music with all us people. It's really inspiring, and man, yeah, can't wait to continue these conversations. In a moment, we'll open up for a Q&A, but after that, please stick around, because Ruben and I are gonna be playing some vinyl records for y'all, and so y'all can talk to us and talk to everybody else here. I think afterwards, there's gonna be some beverages and some snacks for y'all, so please enjoy the time. And with that said, we're gonna open up to questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this talk. This is amazing to hear. It's sad that you don't, I mean, it's sad you can't just go on the LA Times and read this. It's kind of sad. But I wanted to ask, so how does this is for both of you, have you heard of the band Chicano Batman? And how does it come into play with this scene and this book and all that?
I mean, I'm familiar with Chicano Batman, and I guess it comes into play in multiple ways, you know, in so many ways. Chicano Batman is started by our friend Bardo, and who's an amazing musician in person. When I first met Bardo, he was in a band called Buye Pongo, and he played accordion, and they were primarily playing Caribbean and Colombian-based cumbia, and they played early on at Mas Exitos. And yeah, this fits in so many ways. I don't even know where to begin, but the idea of Chicano Batman itself, right? What is Chicano Batman? It's this Chicano superhero. In the beginning of the band's career, they used the United Farm Workers emblem, logo that was used by, Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta, but it had bat wings, or it had bat ears or something like that, to make it a bat. And so very much in line with the Chicano movement and ideas of resistance and soul and Chicano rhythms, conjunto, they were mixing a lot of this stuff up. And I would say my favorite aspect of Chicano Batman is that they were playing baladas. They were playing like Mexican ballads with really wonky organs and synthesizers and stuff. But politically, sonically, I think it's very aligned, and I feel like very much influenced, in some ways by Ruben or by Mas Exitos. His community, Chicano Batman's community. Yeah.
You guys just want conchas, huh?
If you could play a song for somebody who's not familiar with the genre, what's the song you would play for them, or, something along those lines? Also, if you have the song, could you play it?
Okay, do you want a song from what genre?
A song that defines the genre that you write about and what you spoke about today.
I would probably throw down like "The Town I Live In" by the Midnighters, yeah. Yeah, later on, man, I'll drop it, man.
And it's a great song that really has the feeling of Los Angeles in it. And back then and today, I feel like the song and the lyrics and the rhythm still hold true to a Los Angeles oldies, soldies,
that's right,
rock, rhythm, and blues feeling,
Any plans to reissue the first book? The Old Barrio Guide to Lowrider Music? we were talking about that back in the green room, and I'd like to just leave it where it's at, because, since that period, it's the collector, the Chicano collector, I hate to keep using the word lowrider, but the lowrider collector have expanded so much due to the, see, back then we really didn't have the internet, we didn't have social media, and these records that are coming in, they're coming from West Virginia, from Alabama, from Illinois, from Ohio, things that never got played in Los Angeles and never got played outside of these small towns. So that catalog would just grow so big. And, I think I would just like to leave it where it's at right now. Yeah. I might be able to do that, in the future, because the Chicano Soul book, I was just going to put it on for free for anybody to download. And then that's when Texas Tech, they came forward and said, let us publish it. And, that happened. The Japanese published, they translated into Japanese in Japan. So that was like super cool,
And And Ruben got to tour Japan and play his records over there and hang out with all the people who are in love with his material.
Is there anything on radio now that we can enjoy this routinely, weekly, daily, monthly?
You're the radio dude.
Well, I have a show called Más Éxitos con Ganas on Dub Lab Radio, and it focuses on Chicano, Mexican, Central, South American, Caribbean-based records, tapes, CDs. I'm going to start playing VHS on there soon, too. But it's not concentrated like this. You might get some shows that are heavily oldies, soul stuff or whatnot, but it's pretty varied. I'm trying to give a large... I'm trying to make my umbrella as large as possible in terms of what I think is Latin-based music, and that was always my goal. But are there old archives of the Southern Soul Spinners on Dub Lab?
Yeah, on Dub Lab. On Dub Lab, we were doing shows on Dub Lab for quite a while. I guess they're in the archives. There's IMG Radio on the internet as well. It's just IMG. And I uploaded hundreds of records for them, and they play, you know, 24 hours, you know.
So you can go to a place there where it's strictly what you've uploaded?
No.
Okay.
It's all kind of like, yeah, mixed in.
Shout out to Dub Lab Radio, also very inspirational and pivotal to what I've been doing. But yeah, check out dublab.com. and look up Southern Soul Spinners for archived shows.
Hello, Ruben. Thank you so much for tonight. You dropped some really amazing bits of knowledge about the whole thing that you've been researching and collecting on. And I'm just very curious, what would you say is like, or what moment did the record began to basically have the two sides? Like, who would you attribute that to? That started the branding force for this to become a, like a staple? Because it must have been one band or two bands that were dealing with a problem of an audience, but who would you attribute that to as like the one that solved that problem?
Well, the single, it's always been two-sided, you know, and going back, you know, as when they started pressing on 78s, and it pretty much has followed the same pattern, like a dance side and a ballad side. And I mean, that goes back to the doo-wop years and in the 50s and stuff.
I mean in Spanish.
Oh, man. You know what? You think, like, you? I would say, I don't know. No, but I think, for me, like Freddie Fender, 1957, man, he did some really good cuts. He did the same songs in English and Spanish. Richie Valens came around just right after him, No, other than La Bamba, he didn't really, you know, go down that
road. Little Joe and the Latineers, maybe?
Yeah, you talk about, like, Little Joe, Sonny and the Sunliners, but that comes later. But I would say Freddie Fender was probably under the name Baltimore Huerta, not under Freddie Fender. Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
So, Ruben, you mentioned your mother being this really dominant force in your childhood informing your musical enjoyment. What do you think would have been the cascading effect of you honing in on your craft had she not been that force in your life and made that impression on you?
Wow. You know, I have no idea, because she just let us be who we were going to be. You know, and anything, any change in anything sets you off on another direction, you know, in the way someone treats, you know, someone reacts to you, someone treats you. If, you know, if she had been like more like, you better go to school type of thing, because I didn't go to school. And she knew I didn't go to school. You know, just like, I didn't like school. I didn't want to go to school. And, but she just let me be myself. And a lot of times, instead of going to school, I was in the downtown library, like stuck between books, because I like books more than I like being in front of a teacher. And she never like really said too much, you know. So I don't know. I don't know what, maybe I would have been like an engineer or something, you know. I mean, right? But then I wouldn't have no fun. No, just kidding.
A question I have. I mean, Hugo brought up something interesting, I think, this idea of you have Spanish on one side, English on the other side. And then what that really does, it creates a third space, another cultural space to develop, because the people who are listening to that, they're bilingual. They'll hear the Spanish, they'll hear the English. And so there's this whole other space that starts to develop, and we were talking about structural, what are the structural forms that allow for a certain kind of difference to develop and sort of push past what we have now, this sort of like opposition, black and white, let's say. We have this other space. And so I'm thinking about that, let's say with the, you brought the Lowriders and cruising and the music that goes with that. And I thought about the ronda. So that is a kind of engagement of a courtship, you know. So Agustin Lara does that, it produces that waltz in 1935, becomes a big hit. My parents listen to that. And then you bring it forward from 1935, you bring it to in the 50s or 60s when you get the lowriders going, and the cruising takes the place of walking around. So this idea that now you're, that's another cultural space that gets developed. So I think that's what's really interesting about, it's not just the idea of the music as enjoyment, but it's this idea of the music as creating another way of being. And I think that's the really important thing, because music is such a, it speaks to the soul. You know, you don't have to really be an intellectual to understand it. You just feel it. And by creating that other kind of feeling, it creates possibility for difference to exist. And I think that's something that's really important in terms of art. You know, if you look at just to look at art, like, okay, that was what the Rococo did. Or if you look at Mexican churches, that opens up this whole other space. So I think that's a really important thing. So I really appreciate you like doing this and having this talk. That wasn't a question, I guess, just a comment.
Thank you. No, I think it's an important statement also, because, you know, collecting Latin-based records, a kind of full circle that's happened for me is collecting records from Tijuana and Mexico City that are covering a lot of Texas-based, Los Angeles-based oldies and soul. And this, you know, the oldies and soul being something more that was locale to me and something that, like, I heard on the radio or saw the CDs or records or had them, were in my family. Now I'm looking for that other interpretation of them even more so, and to the point where now I'm starting to forget who the original artist is, man. I'm just like, oh, yeah, that's from Los Tijuana Five or something, and I'm like, oh yeah, I gotta remember, like, that track came out, you know, in the United States by this person at that year, you know. And so yeah, now I've been enjoying that other space you're talking about with these same songs and records from these places but made somewhere else, you know. Like, one of my favorites lately is I got a track from Honduras, and they're doing Kraftwerk, The Model, and records from Honduras are just hard to get, period, just because the space, terrain, revolution, all that type of stuff. And this track is made in the same year, and it just sounds 20 times better than Kraftwerk, and no disrespect to Kraftwerk, they're amazing, right? But you start to have all these different experiences or vibes. Studios sound different, instruments sound different, approaches sound different, changing the lyrics, to fit another language makes things different, you know? And or you get somebody singing in English from Mexico and it's all broken, and that sounds rad as hell, you know? But I love the comment. Thank you.
And we're actually out of time for questions. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. mano, como te la tira suave, solo acostado en el macate.
Pensabas mucho en mí. después te fuiste y te seguí mirando en las gotas cristalinas de la lluvia, en el incesante brillo de las estrellas y en la palidez hermosa.
Chiquita, ay, mi just now you see. Our love can be sad, girl. Forget that guy. Come on, let's smile now. Please won't you try? Get a hold of yourself. Come on and find someone else. Open up your heart, girl. Make a settle, make a brand new start. Please don't you cry. Just go out and find yourself another guy.
Thank you. lluvia al caer y lo bello que ha de ser cuando luego salga el sol. Veo tu imagen sin querer y cada vez que pienso en ti siento ganas de ir contigo, amor.
Y es que tú y yo
fuimos hechos para estar,
solos tú y yo
y nadie más.
Y es que tú y yo
somos nuestra realidad,
solo tú y yo
y nadie más. Quiero tu risa alrededor, nunca lágrimas que son, solo agua que se pierde, amor. Dicen que sabio esperar, pero nunca hay que dejar que se escape el tiempo sin amar.
Y es que tú y yo
fuimos hechos para estar,
solo tú y yo
y nadie más.
Y es que tú y yo
somos nuestra realidad,
solo tú y yo
y nadie más. Fuimos hechos para estar,
solos tú y yo
y nadie más.
Solo tú y yo. Y es que tú y yo
somos nuestra realidad,
solos tú y yo
y nadie más.
Y es que tú y yo
fuimos hechos para estar,
solos tú y yo.
Nadie más.
Y es que tú y yo
somos nuestra realidad,
solo tú y yo
y nadie más.
Y es que tú y yo
fuimos hechos para estar,
solo tú y yo
y nadie más.
Amo tanto. han querido dar falso amor para engañar y los deja así, deja así. Promesas de amor introducen el dolor que vas a sentir, a sentir. El mundo no te puede. Y mi amor, tú vas a comprender, comprender que yo nunca te engañaré. De mí, sé que tú me quieres y olvida tu vanidad. La vida es corta en este mundo, con un amor feliz así se goza, pero creo que tú ya no es lo que quieres, pues entonces mi amor, yo te voy a decir tal y como eres. No soy tu juguete, anda y busca de alguien más. Anda y busca de alguien más. Dilo como eres. No soy tu juguete. Anda y busca de alguien más. Stop us from
I'm alone. tell you that I cry. Cause I love my baby. If you see him, tell him to come on home.
lo cante a esos pachucos que no saben trabajar. Hay cuervos tan elegantes de tirante y pantalón que no saben trabajar, pero le hacen al talón. Usan su pelo ondulado y muy envaselinado, sus pantalones de embudo para que den resultado. Unos tirantes de a cuarta, el saco estilo levita, la corbatita no falta para engañar su chavita. Pidiendo trola, el camita no se escame porque la cura anda alerta. Hay que ponernos al alba, hay que hacernos mosca muerta. Adiós todos los pachucos que escuchan alrededor, ya se despide de ustedes cantando un madrugador.
Thank you.